I'm going to talk about where the chemical elements come from. If you want something close to a symbol, I'm going to talk about the R process and the S process. We're going to talk about chemical elements, which means I need to venture alarmingly close to chemistry and actually talk a little bit about the periodic table. So first, let me show you an astronomer's periodic table, which is this. There are only three things in the universe as far as astronomers are concerned. There's hydrogen, helium, and everything else, which we tend to call metals. And the fraction of each we tend to call X, Y, and Z. I'm only showing this because it really annoys chemists. But actually, to a large extent, it's sort of helpful because actually one of the things that astronomers broadly know is that hydrogen and helium were mainly made in the Big Bang and everything else was more or less made in stars. If you do it by mass, it's about 3/4 hydrogen, 1/4 helium, and a tiny bit of everything else, so a few percent of everything else. So no, these are not to scale in that sense. All right. But it turns out astronomers do actually know a bit more about chemical elements and where they come from that. And in fact, there's a very nice graphic that appeared a little while ago that tries to summarize it. It's caused quite a lot of discussion and debate in the astronomical community, but at least to a first approximation, it kind of tells you what's going on. And it sort of reflects the story that I've just told you, that hydrogen and helium were made in the Big Bang, and pretty much everything else was made in stars. Now, it turns out, of course, that that's not true when you start looking in detail at things. So, for example, when you start looking at all the very heavy elements, which have very short lifetimes, the only way we can actually make those is by making them ourselves, because anything that was made in stars has long since decayed away. So the very heavy elements are actually human-made rather than star-made. And actually, it turns out when you look at the light end of things, things are a little more complicated as well, because you've got things like lithium and beryllium. You see, you've got little C's next to them here. They're actually made through a process called cosmic ray spallation. Cosmic rays are these very high energy particles whizzing through space. And when one of that very high energy particle, it could be an atomic nucleus, whacks into another particle, could be another atomic nucleus, you can actually have fission occurring. The atomic nuclei can fall apart. So something which was initially a heavier element can actually be splattered into these little bits. We believe the main way that lithium and beryllium and boron get made is through that spallation process. So they weren't actually made in stars. Well, at least something heavier was probably made in a star, but then it got smashed to pieces through cosmic ray interactions. The broad story is that hydrogen and helium made in the Big Bang, then you have stars. Stars in their center fuse lighter elements to heavier elements because that's how they're powered, they're fusion powered. And so you can make heavier elements. One of the main ways you make heavy elements is in the core of a star when you've got hydrogen turning into helium and helium turning into carbon and so on. But that kind of gives out at iron, because once you get to iron, then making heavier things by smashing iron nuclei together, it turns out that absorbs energy rather than giving energy out. So you stop getting energy out of the process when you get to iron. And of course, if you're trying to power a star, you need to get energy out. So stars give up once they get to iron. And so again, the simple law in astronomy is hydrogen and helium came in the Big Bang. Everything up to iron was made in the centers of stars. And then everything heavier than iron only gets made in supernovae. Because when a star explodes, then you have lots of energy around and you can have these very inefficient processes. You're not trying to power a star anymore. So actually you can smack things together and create the heavier elements like gold and all the heavier things there are around get made in supernovae. And if you look at this plot, that's kind of true. In that if you just look at it, so we've got the green and the yellow is stuff that's made in stars, and you can see all the lighter elements as we go down the periodic table tend to be green in nature till we get to about iron. And then they sort of start turning more to this pinky orange color, which is supernovae. And so you can see the more massive elements tend to get made in supernovae. But interestingly, it's not entirely true. It's not like everything stops at iron and then suddenly everything's made in supernovae. And in particular, if you look at these guys here, so now I'm gonna have to struggle with my command of the periodic table and chemistry in general, that's barium, lanthanum, and cerium. You can see they're actually made in stars, but they're way heavier than iron, right? Iron's somewhere way up here, and these are right down towards the bottom of the periodic table. And so the question is, how on earth do you end up with these heavy elements, which clearly aren't made in supernovae, but are actually are made in stars somewhere along the line? And that's where we get to this thing called the R process and the S process. It's actually quite hard to make a heavy element because you have to take, so if you're going to make a heavy element through fusion, you've got to take two fairly heavy nuclei and smack them together and get them to stick. And heavy nuclei have quite large charges associated with them. So, you know, hydrogen only has one unit, one proton. But by the time you get to these heavier elements, they actually have lots of protons. So they have lots of positive charge, lots of positive charge. So actually they repel each other very effectively. So it's very hard to make heavy elements just by smacking nuclei together. Turns out there's an easier way to make heavier elements, which is that if you've got a neutron, a neutral particle, and you kind of make that stick to a nucleus, so you basically smack it into a nucleus, it'll stick, and that'll add to the weight of the nucleus. Now you haven't actually changed the chemical at that point because, so chemicals, the chemical properties of something depend on how many protons there are in it, not how many neutrons there are in it. So adding a neutron to it just changes the isotope of the chemical, it doesn't actually change the chemical. But neutrons can then decay through a process called beta decay, and then the neutron basically turns into a proton and kicks out an electron and a neutrino in the process.
So you've sneaked a proton in there by the back door?
Exactly. Without having to overcome these Coulomb repulsions, I managed to sneak an extra particle in, which then magically turns into a proton, so I've changed the element that way. So it turns out that's actually the main way you make these heavy elements, it's just by adding neutrons. And in a supernova, there's loads of neutrons around, huge neutron flux, because there's lots of everything around in a supernova. It's a complete mess. And so you can have a nucleus, and you can just basically bombard a whole load of neutrons into it, and then it'll end up a very heavy isotope of whatever it started with. But then those neutrons will go bing, 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 and will beta decay down into protons. So you can end up creating heavier elements that way. And that works great. You can actually, you know, it decays once and that moves it one place up the periodic table because you've added a proton effectively, and then it decays again. And so you can kind of walk your way up the periodic table that way. The problem is that sooner or later in that process, you'll reach a stable isotope, one which will just stay there forever. So it'll decay for a while and then it'll stick. And that means that anything kind of further upstream from that nucleus, you can't make anymore because you've got stuck at that point where everything's decayed as far as it's going to, and nothing else is going to happen to it after that. So what I've just described is a thing called the R process, R standing for rapid, because you added a whole bunch of neutrons very rapidly. Now, there are other chemicals that exist in the universe that are kind of blocked by this process, that they wouldn't actually form from this process. And the only way you can make those is through this thing called the S process, which is the slow process, which is that you add a neutron, you wait for it to decay, it turns into a proton, it changes it, and then you add another neutron and you wait for it to decay and it turns into the next element up. And that way you don't have this kind of blocking effect, because you can always just add another neutron and then it'll decay and so on. So through that process you can get to a whole other set of elements through this thing called the S process that don't get made through the R process, but you can, you know, there are other decay chains that will get you to these S process elements. But in a supernova, everything happens very quickly, right? Because you've got this massive neutron flux and then it's all over in, you know, hours.
So you only get one go to add all your neutrons.
Exactly, and these decays, if you do this S process, you know, you add a neutron, sometimes these decays can take weeks, months, years, thousands of years. And so actually, that S process is never gonna work in a supernova, because you've added one, and by the time it's decayed to the next thing along, the whole supernova's over, and so you're not gonna add any more neutrons. And so things which are made through this S process can't be made in supernovae. So we have to look somewhere else where there is this process where you can add neutrons to things, but over a much longer period of time, tens of years, hundreds of years, thousands of years, rather than all in one go. And it turns out that in the late stages of some stars' lives, they actually produce quite a lot of free neutrons, some of the late stage burning things. So when you're burning carbon into heavier elements and so on, you actually liberate quite a few neutrons along the way. And so there are free neutrons over the hundreds of thousands of years that the star is going through this phase of its lifetime, kind of bimbling around within the star, which means that you can actually then over time add neutrons through this S process. These elements here that I was talking about before, barium, lanthanum, cerium, they're only made through this S process. And that means that the only way they can possibly be made is that there was probably from a previous generations of stars, there was a fairly heavy element in the star, like iron or something like that, which then had, late in the lifetime of the star, had this sort of free neutron flux bumping into it over tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of years, which would, through this S process, turn it into one of these heavier elements like barium. It's quite interesting that whenever you get some barium, you know pretty much how that has to have formed, and it's actually quite a long story.
This is a rod of barium we've got in here.
That there must have been a first generation of stars that went supernovae, threw out lots of heavy elements that were produced through this R process, but that wouldn't have made the barium. Then some of those heavy elements were then incorporated into a later generation of stars. Late in the lifetime of that particular star, there was a strong neutron flux within the star, which would then, through this S process, get it up to these heavy elements like barium and lanthanum.
Quite a journey some of those atoms have been on.
It really is, and it's kind of astounding that just by sort of understanding the nuclear physics and how these various chemical elements get made, you can actually trace, you know, when you've got one of these elements, you can actually look at it and say, well, I know how this must have formed. And it's quite, as you say, it's a kind of long and involved story in some of these elements.
We should be able to file a little bit of the barium onto this foil. Oh, I can see little bits coming off actually, but they're very, very small.